Funding for Frontline is provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide, and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Tonight on Frontline, an investigation of the CIA and its role in international drug dealing.
The history of the CIA runs parallel to criminal and drug operations throughout the world, but it's coincidental.
Is the CIA using drug money to finance covert operations?
Narcotics proceeds were used to shore up the Contra effort.
Something's wrong. Something is really wrong out there.
Tonight, guns, drugs, and the CIA.
From the network of public television stations, a presentation of KCTS Seattle, WNET New York, WPBT Miami, WTVS Detroit, and WGBH Boston. This is Frontline with Judy Woodruff.
Good evening. Two of the most persistent offensives of the Reagan presidency have been the war against communism in Central America and the war on drugs here at home. But investigations of America's secret war in Nicaragua have revealed mounting evidence that the Central Intelligence Agency has been fighting the Contra war with the help of international drug traffickers. It is not a new story. Tonight's Frontline investigation traces the CIA's involvement with drug lords back to the agency's birth following World War II. It is a long history that asks this question. In the war on drugs, which side is the CIA on? Our program was produced by Leslie and Andrew Coburn. It is called Guns, Drugs, and the CIA, and is reported by Leslie Coburn.
Illegal drugs are one thing no community in America can, should, or needs to tolerate. America's already starting to take that message to heart. That's why I believe the tide of battle has turned, and we're beginning to win the crusade for a drug-free America.
Subcommittee on Narcotics, Terrorism, International Operations will come to order. From what we have learned these past months, our declaration on war against drugs seems to have produced a war of words and not action. Our borders are inundated with more narcotics than at any time ever before. It seems as though stopping drug trafficking in the United States has been a secondary U.S. foreign policy objective, sacrificed repeatedly for other political and institutional goals, such as changing the government of Nicaragua, supporting the government of Panama, using drug-running organizations as intelligence assets, and protecting military and intelligence sources from possible compromise through involvement in drug trafficking.
If we start with the premise that drug trafficking is morally reprehensible, our government agencies are not supposed to do anything like that. But they deal in a practical world.
Would you raise your right hand, please?
Ramon Millan Rodriguez saw that world as the chief accountant of the Colombian cocaine cartel, responsible for managing $11 billion in drug profits. Now serving a 43-year sentence for money laundering, he has been a key witness for a Senate investigation probing links between drugs and the CIA.
Let's say, for instance, a drug group was involved in a war with a terrorist group, a communist terrorist group. Well, it would behoove the CIA to give that drug group as much help and advice as possible so they could win their little war.
The history of the CIA runs parallel to criminal and drug operations throughout the world, but it's coincidental.
Victor Marchetti came to know the world of covert operations as a longtime CIA officer. He is the highest-ranking agency official ever to go public about what he learned.
It goes all the way back to the predecessor organization, OSS, and its involvement with the Italian mafia, or La Cosa Nostra, in Sicily and southern Italy. Later on, when they were fighting the communists in France and that, they got in tight with the Corsican Brotherhood. The Corsican Brotherhood, of course, were big dope dealers. as things changed in the world, the CIA got involved with Kuomintang types in Burma who were drug runners because they were resisting the drift towards communism there. Same thing happened in Southeast Asia, later in Latin America. And some of the very people who are the best sources of information or who are capable of accomplishing things and the like happen to be the criminal element.
The CIA has had a solid rule against being involved in drug trafficking. That's not to say that some of the people whom CIA has used or been in touch with over the years may well have themselves been involved in drug traffic, but not the CIA.
If the CIA is going to, if their job is to maintain the safety of our country and freedom by manipulating foreign powers to do what this country wants, and if the guy that's holding the power at that particular moment happens to be a drug lord, then you have to get involved with the drug lord.
As a result, we kept getting involved with these kind of people, not for drug purposes and not for personal gain, but to achieve a higher ideological goal.
In a refugee camp in northeast Thailand, there live the remnants of one such involvement. They are the Hmong or Mayo tribe. While American troops were fighting in Vietnam, these people were the foot soldiers of a secret CIA army. They fought an undeclared war in northern Laos, across the border from North Vietnam.
They're hill people. They're little guys. Like most hill people, they're pretty fierce. In Laos, we were the guerrillas. The war in Laos was a textbook example of what can be done in unconventional warfare.
General Richard Secord is one of many veterans of the CIA's secret war in Laos. Because Laos was officially neutral, American troops could not be used. The CIA relied on massive air power and a tribal army to fight the local communists and the North Vietnamese. On the ground in northern Laos, a handful of CIA officers directed as many as 85,000 soldiers drawn from the mountain tribes. But American officials did more than just send their allies into battle.
Early on, I think that we all believed that what we were doing was in the best interest of America, that we were in fact perhaps involved in some not so desirable aspects of the drug traffic. However, we believed strongly in the beginning that we were there for a just cause.
Ron Rickenback served in Laos as an official for the U.S. Agency for International Development from 1962 to 1969. He was on the front lines.
These people were willing to take up arms. We needed to stop the red threat. And people believed that in that vein, you made, you know, certain compromises or certain trade-offs for a larger good. Growing opium was a natural agricultural enterprise for these people, and they had been doing it for many, many years before the Americans ever got there. When we got there, they continued to do so.
When they would move from one place to another, they would carry their little bags of opium. They smoked it, by the way, in pipes. Opium could be bought in the streets of any village.
When a farmer raised a crop of opium, what he got for his year's worth of work was the equivalent of 35 to 40 U.S. dollars. That amount of opium, were it refined into morphine base, then into morphine, then into heroin, and appeared on the streets of New York, that $35 crop of opium would be worth $50, $60, $100,000 in 1969 dollars. Maybe it's $1 million today.
The war isolated the Mayo tribespeople in their remote villages. CIA-owned Air America planes became their only lifeline to the outside world. While Mayo children came to believe that rice fell from the sky, Mayo farmers, witnesses say, could count on Air America to move their cash crop.
It was then the presence of these air support services in and out of the areas in question where the product, where the opium was grown, that greatly facilitated an increase in production and an ease of transshipment from the point of agriculture to the point of processing. So when I say the Americans greased the wheels, essentially what I'm saying is we did not create opium production. We did not create a situation where drug trafficking was happening. But because of the nature of our presence, this very intense American means that was made available to the situation, it accelerated in proportion dramatically.
The possibility that Air America flew drugs is still hotly disputed by many former senior officers.
You can question any number of people who were there, who actually were there, not people who claim that they had some knowledge of rumors. You can question any number of people, and I venture to say that they will all support what I'm saying, and that is that there was no commercial trade in opium going on.
When I was on the airstrip, that was my job, to move in and about and to go from place to place, and my people were in charge of dispatching aircraft. I was in the areas where opium was transshipped. I personally was a witness to opium being placed on aircraft, American aircraft. I witnessed it being taken off smaller aircraft that were coming in from outlying sites.
Yes, I've seen the sticky bricks come on board, and no one was challenging their right to carry it. It was their own property.
Neil Hansen is a former senior Air America pilot, now serving a sentence for smuggling cocaine.
We were some sort of a freebie airline in some respects there. Whoever the customer or the local representative put on the airplane, we flew. Primarily, it was transported on our smaller aircraft, the Helios, the Porters, and things like that, that would visit the little outlying villages. They would send their opium to market.
From the villages, the planes took their cargo over the mountains to Long Chen, CIA headquarters for the war. It was a secret city, unmarked on any map and carefully hidden from outsiders. Long Chen became one of the busiest airports in the world, with hundreds of landings and takeoffs a day.
And at the height of the war, then there were thousands of people in there. There were villages all over. There were landing pads up on what we call Skyline Drive, which was the ridge on the north side of Long Chen. T-28s were going in and out of there. C-130s were going in and out of there. It was an amazing place, just amazing.
Ed Dearborn is a veteran of Long Chen and Air America, a key figure in the covert air operation.
From a sleepy little valley and village, you know, surrounded by the mountains and the cars, to this great war machine actually working up there. It was the heart and pulse of Laos at that time, more commonly referred to as the CIA's secret base, you know.
To lead their Mayo army, the CIA selected Vang Pao, a former lieutenant in the French colonial army in Laos. The agency made every effort to boost his reputation.
His name was Vang Pao, a charismatic, passionate, and committed man, a patriot without a country.
Vang Pao, however, did more than just lead his people in war. According to observers, he and his officers dominated the trade in the Mayo farmers' cash crop. In 1968, one visitor got a first-hand look at this trade in a village called Long Pot.
I was given the guest bed in the village, in fact, the district headman's house, and I ended up sharing it with a guy in military uniform who I later found out was an officer of the Vang Pao army. And one morning I was woken very early by this great confusion of people and noise at the bottom of the bed. I mean, just literally people brushing up against my feet with these packets of black sticky substance in bamboo tubes and wrapped up in leaves and bits and things. And the military officer was there, was weighing it out and paying off, you know, a considerable amount of money to these people. And this went on, you know, for most of the morning, and it went on for several mornings, and he bought up a great deal of this substance, which I then started to think about and, you know, asked and had it confirmed that this was in fact raw opium.
War photographer John Everingham has lived in Southeast Asia for over 20 years. He was one of the very few outsiders who dared to look for and photograph the secret army for himself.
they all wore American supplied uniforms. And the villagers very innocently and very openly told me, oh, they took it to Longcheng. And I asked them how they took it, and they said, oh, well, they took it on the helicopters, as everything else that went to and from Longcheng went by helicopter, and so did the opium.
And whose helicopters were they?
Well, they were the Air America helicopters, which were on contract to the CIA.
We did not go down to the embassy and be privy to their secret briefings or anything else. We flew the airplanes. If they put something on the airplane and told you not to look at it, you didn't look at it because you'd no longer be employed.
I know as a fact that soon after the army was formed, the military officers soon got control of the opium trade. It helped not only them make a lot of money and become good, loyal officers to the CIA, but it helped the villagers. I mean, the villagers needed their opium carried out, and carried over land in a war situation was much more dangerous and more difficult. And the officers were obviously paying a good price because the villagers were very eager to sell to the military people.
That's hogwash. No way, and as far as the agency, ever advocating. That is, do you think that I would be in an organization where I've devoted my life to my country, involved in an operation like that without blowing the whistle? Absolutely not.
God be with us until we meet again. By your counsel's guide, uphold us. With your own, securely fold us. God be with us till we meet again.
For veterans like General Aderholt and General Secord, the war in Laos is now commemorated at nostalgic reunions. Last fall, they gathered at a Florida airbase to talk over old times and current business. While Vang Pao does not attend such functions, he is well remembered by his old comrades.
Was the agency responsible for people's salaries? Were they paying Vang Pao?
Oh, of course, they were 100% responsible. Because Vang Pao was responding to agency requirements. Even though they may have come from the highest level of the U.S. government. Yes, of course.
He was in the chain of command.
Yes.
Did you work with Vang Pao?
Sure, all the time.
What was your relationship?
I was his supplier of air, therefore he stayed in close contact with me.
Were you in charge of supplying Air America planes?
For the tactical air operations, yes.
The movement of Air America planes, say witnesses, was influenced by Vang Pao's business requirements.
Vang Pao wanted control of the aircraft. Sure, he would do the work that needed to be done, but it would give him that much more freedom and that much more flexibility to use these aircraft to go out and pick up the opium that needed to be picked up at this site or that site and to bring it back to Longcheng. And there was quite a hassle, and Vang Pao won. And not only did he get control of the aircraft, but there was also a question of the operational control of the airplane that were leaving Vientiane to go south, even into Thailand. And there was an embarrassing situation where the Americans knew that this could be exposed, and it would be a very compromising situation. The way they got around that was to concede to create for Vang Pao his own local airline. And Xing Huang Airlines came into reality as a direct result of this compromise that was worked out. And they brought in a C-47 from the States, and they painted it up nice and put Xing Huang Airlines on it, and they gave it to Vang Pao. And that aircraft was largely used for the transshipment of opium from Longcheng to sites further south.
Air opium.
Those airplanes didn't really belong to General Vang Pao.
They belonged to the agency.
They belonged to the agency. They were maintained by the United States government in the form of Air America or Continental. So they didn't really own anything. It wasn't something he could take away with him. It's something that we controlled every iota of that operation, lock, stock, and barrel.
You know what the nickname for that airline was?
No.
Opium Air.
I've never heard that before.
Back in the old days, the men who flew for Air America and drank in the Purple Porpoise were less discreet. Most of them are long gone and far away from Laos now. But one legendary CIA officer still lives across the Mekong River, close to his old mountain battleground.
The man that was in charge of that local operation was a man by the name of Tony Poe, and he was notorious. He had been involved with the agency from the OSS days. He was a World War II combat veteran and had been with the agency from its inception, and he was the prototype operations officer. They made a movie about him when they made Apocalypse Now. He was the caricature of Marlon Brando.
Until now, Tony Poe has never talked publicly about the Laos operation. He saw it from beginning to end. One of Vang Pao's early case officers, Poe claims he was transferred from Long Chen because, unlike his successors, he refused to tolerate the Mao leader's corruption.
You don't let him run loose without a chain on him. You got to control him. It's like any kind of an animal or a baby. You have to control him. Hey, he's the only guy that had a pair of shoes when I first met him. What are we talking about? Why does he need Mercedes-Benz apartments and hotels and homes for? He never had them in his life before. Why are you going to give it to him?
Plus, he was making money on the side with his business.
Oh, he's making a million. Because he had his own source of avenue for his own heroin.
What did he do with the money?
What do you mean? U.S. bank accounts? Switzerland? Wherever.
Didn't they know when Vang Pao said, "I want some aircraft"? Didn't they know what he wanted that for?
I'm sure we all knew it, what was going to, but we were trying to monitor it because we control most of the pilots, you see. We're giving him a freedom of navigation in the Thailand, in the bases. And we don't want him to get involved in moving, you know, this illicit traffic. Okay, silver bars and gold, okay, but not heroin. What they would do is they weren't going into Thailand, they were flying it in a big wet wing airplane. It could fly for 13 hours, a DC-3, and all the wings were filled with gas. They fly down to Pak Se, then they fly over to Da Nang, and then the number two guy, the President Tu, would receive it.
Nguyen Van Chiu was president of South Vietnam from 1967 to 1975. Reports at that time accused President Tu of financing his election through the heroin trade. Like Vang Pao, he always denied it, remaining America's honored and indispensable ally.
They were all in a contractual relationship. Some of this goes to me and some goes to the... And, you know, just like bankers and businessmen, they had a bookkeeping. We delivered you on a certain day. They had coded messages. And that means that so-and-so, or this much comes back, goes into our Swiss bank account. Boom, they had a wonderful relationship. And maybe 6 months, they'd all come together at a party somewhere and talk about their business, good or bad. You can like the mafia. Big organized mafia.
By the end of 1970, there were 30,000 Americans in Vietnam addicted to heroin. GIs were dying from overdoses at the rate of two a day.
When the drug traffic became a real problem to the American troops in Vietnam, then the CIA was asked by our president to get involved in the program to limit that traffic and stop it.
But in 1972, a U.S. intelligence agent in Southeast Asia sent a secret field report to Customs. It suggested a serious conflict of interest. Quote, "It was ironic that the CIA should be given the responsibility of narcotics intelligence, particularly since they were supporting the prime movers. Even though the CIA was, in fact, facilitating the movement of opiates to the U.S., they steadfastly hid behind the shield of secrecy and said that all was done in the interest of national security," end quote.
I doubt that they had any real strong, deep understanding of what they were allowing to happen by turning their head the other way and letting Vang Pao ship his dope out, which was made into heroin, which was going to our troops, which was corrupting people throughout Southeast Asia and back here, the effect it had on crime. And I doubt that any one of them really thought in those terms at the time.
While the heroin trade was flourishing by 1970, the war in Laos was going badly. As the communists steadily advanced, the civilian population faced a choice between evacuation to refugee camps or being bombed by the U.S. Air Force. These operations only added to the huge cost of feeding, training, and supplying the secret army. For a war that did not officially exist, the CIA was spending heavily.
The money was always there. We had a program. In fact, that's the reason the agency supply system was so much better than the military supply system.
Cash.
They didn't have to go through a procurement system, a bureaucracy that made everything cost three times as much.
On two different occasions, I brought bags up that I knew was payroll. Wish I'd have crashed on those times and been able to stick that somewhere back in the jungle and go get it, because it was unaccounted funds.
How much money would be in a bag?
Well, a bag would probably have a couple hundred thousand dollars in it, depending on where you were going with it and who it was going to.
I was sitting up there on the director's staff, and that's where it all came together.
For operations such as Laos, the CIA director's senior staff prepared the agency's official budget.
For Laos, I think it was around 30 million, perhaps 40 million, but it was very small.
Was that in fact enough to run this war?
Well, I don't think so. I would think that the war was costing quite a bit. If all the costs were pulled together, I would imagine it would probably cost as much as the entire agency's budget.
How was the war in Laos financed?
U.S. appropriated funds.
Through which agency?
I think through the CIA and through the Defense Department, both.
A secret Pentagon report put the Defense Department contribution to the war in Laos at $146 million in 1970. But the report also showed that the CIA was spending up to $60 million more than they were getting from Congress.
Well, there may have been other funds generated by Vang Pao himself through his dope operations. They were poppy growers and opium smugglers. So I imagine there was money being earned that way. That was Vang Pao's contribution to the war.
Is it conceivable that the CIA would fight a war with dope money?
Well, yes, in the sense that they would not sell dope to earn money to support an operation, but they would look the other way if the people they were supporting were financing themselves by selling dope.
General Vang Pao was financed by U.S. government funds.
How much was he getting?
I don't know what General Vang Pao was getting, but the Mao program, I'm sure, ran several hundred million dollars at the end to fight a war like we were fighting and to have an airline. I don't know what the funding was, but I'm sure the congressional committees have access to those records.
As a former chief counsel for the House Select Committee on Narcotics, Joe Nellis did indeed have access to the records.
Vang Pao had a heavy hand in the production of heroin in that area.
How much of the money that was going to pay these thousands and thousands of tribesmen to fight for us, for the CIA, where was that money coming from?
From the trade.
From the opium trade?
Yes, surely.
How would that work?
Well, money would be paid for the transportation and the safe arrival of the merchandise to its proper destination. And that money would be paid to the carrier, the person transporting the merchandise. And then that money would be used to pay off the farmers. But as I told you, they got so little of it that there was an enormous amount left over. And it was that money that was used to feed to the peasants in order to get them to continue not only fighting for us, but also continuing to give us very important intelligence about the movement of the North Vietnamese.
We wouldn't have permitted it. It would have been too dangerous.
Why?
You know, because the American system wouldn't put up with it.
I have never revealed any classified information that I obtained when I was with the committee, and I'm not going to start now. But I do know that that was verified.
That it was known here?
Yes.
Well, without getting into classified information, was that at a high level or a low level?
Well, I can't discuss the level. Let's put it this way. You're familiar with the Iran-Contra business?
Yes.
That was known at a very high level. It was known at all sorts of levels, really. It's amazing that they could keep it secret as long as they did. And I guess that was the situation with Air America, that the people in CIA certainly knew it. And at that time, Dick Helms, I think, was the head of the office, and I'm sure he must have reported it to Nixon.
Former CIA Director Richard Helms told us, quote, "I knew nothing of this. It certainly was not policy."
It's patently impossible. There are thousands of people involved in the intelligence community of the United States who read the reports, who are intimately familiar with details of field activities. And no such operation could ever be kept secret from the authorities in Washington. It would never be tolerated. Never. Not for a minute.
How many people knew what was going on?
Oh, I don't think it was very many at all.
Five?
A handful. Handful. Maybe 100.
I personally did not complain. Not at the time. I certainly complained after the fact, but that came as a result of my own awakening as to the rather horrible implications of what we were doing. I left working for the government rather abortively because I just could not tolerate myself what was going on.
His disgust was not only at the drug trade, but at the human cost of a war in which the recruits were as young as 8 years old.
These people were absolutely decimated. The war itself took its own toll. Thousands and thousands of these people were either maimed or killed or died of disease or malnutrition secondary to the effects of the war. Many were bombed. Many were blown away by conflict and combat. What was left after the war was the exodus to the South or to the West. These people have had their whole life destroyed for helping out in our war. For helping out in our war.
By 1981, 6 years after leaving Laos, the CIA was fighting another secret war, this time in Central America. The secret army were the Contras, fighting to overthrow the leftist government of Nicaragua. Once again, they were trained and equipped by the CIA. It was time for the old hands to go to work again.
It's an irregular war in Central America, and there aren't a lot of people who have experience in irregular warfare, paramilitary warfare, so it would be natural to see people who are experienced in this kind of operation utilized again.
It's the old boy network, as somebody called it one time. You know, I mean, the call goes out, and who's got the experience? It's the same war, different place, and different names. We're not speaking Laotian, we're speaking Spanish now, but it's the same darn war. I don't care what anybody says.
Eugene Hazenfuss was just one of a number of veterans from Laos who answered the call in Central America. When his plane was shot down over Nicaragua in October 1986, an Air America handbook turned up in the wreckage. Hazenfuss had operated out of the Ilopango Air Base in El Salvador, headquarters for the White House Contra Resupply Network. His commander there had been a veteran of another old CIA network. Felix Rodriguez, a Cuban-American, had been sent down from Miami.
The feeling that I see now in the Nicaraguan freedom fighters, I know their experience, because I was left inside once, and I wanted to help them as much as I could.
Like Rodriguez, the Miami Cubans of Brigade 2506 are still ready to support the anti-communist cause, 30 years after their failed invasion of Cuba. They were willing recruits for the CIA's war against Nicaragua. the brigade supplied soldiers in the field, commanders, and fundraisers for the Contra cause. The brigade had been created and trained by the CIA for the Bay of Pigs invasion in 1961. After their defeat, the CIA continued to maintain and use this skilled force of covert operators wherever they were needed. Their numbers grew into the thousands. They had their own navy, as well as other assets provided by the CIA, including businesses and banks.
I was in charge.
Manuel Artime was the agency's favorite Cuban, handpicked to command both the Bay of Pigs and the covert operations that followed. In 1972, he recruited and arranged CIA training for a brilliant young accountant called Ramon Millan Rodriguez.
He ran covert operations out of Miami for the CIA.
So Artime had a whole group of people who were his people.
Oh, yes. Artime ran a very large operation. It was very large. He was very active all over Central and South America.
A lot of Cubans go to work with the Central Intelligence Agency in foreign operations.
He was in charge of, among other things, the Watergate burglars and things like that.
Did you launder any money for the Watergate guys?
I made payments for the Watergate burglars, yes. I started out in life in one scandal, and I have ended it in another, it seems. After Watergate, the group that Manolo Artime was running in Miami was disbanded. The fact that the burglars were Cuban really hurt in Miami. So we had a situation where people were laid off. They were just given the assets. For instance, if you were running a print shop, you kept the print shop. If you had a boat, as there were many boats for surveillance and intelligence, you just kept the boats. And then that was really the starting off point where you got some well-trained people into the drug business.
Many, many Cubans worked for Artime in that time. Some of them have become very successful, good American citizens. Others have become gangsters.
But with a secret Contra war to fight, the agency was more interested in covert skills than good citizenship, particularly when it came to raising money. Ramon Millan Rodriguez was ideally placed. With access to the limitless resources of the Medellin cocaine cartel, he had no problem raising cash.
You've been a supporter living in the Cuban community, passionately anti-communist and anti-Castro. You've also been a supporter of the Contras, is that accurate?
Yes, sir.
Are you aware of whether or not narcotics proceeds at some time may or may not have supported Contra efforts?
Yes, sir. Narcotics proceeds were used to shore up the Contra effort.
Did you personally play a role in some of the transfer of that money?
Yes, I did.
In 1984, when Congress cut off Contra funding, the White House turned to other sources for support. According to documents, Ramon Millan Rodriguez had been laundering foreign payments for the CIA up through 1982, at the same time as he was laundering cash for the cocaine cartel. He says the CIA turned to him again.
To have people like me in place that can be used is marvelous for them. The agency, and quite rightly so, has things that they have to do which they can never admit to an oversight committee, right? And the only way they can fund these things is through drug money or through illicit money that they can get their hands on in some way.
Was any of the money traceable to drugs or to drug-related transactions?
The money that we, you're talking about the money that we provided?
That's right.
No, sir.
And why was that?
Because we're experts at what we do.
Who is Ramon Millan Rodriguez?
He worked for the cartel.
So he was laundering money for the cartel?
Yes.
And he worked with Noriega?
Yes.
Until last year, Jose Blandón was General Manuel Noriega's head of political intelligence in Panama. He was a key U.S. government witness for the grand jury that indicted Noriega for drug trafficking. General Noriega was more than ready to support the Reagan administration in the Contra War after Congress cut off funding.
How important was Noriega to the White House in the Contra resupply effort?
He played a key role in the supply of arms to the Contra.
So when various administration officials like Oliver North met with General Noriega, did they know that he was involved with narcotics trafficking?
I think that the United States had information that Noriega is involved in drugs since at least 8 years.
8 years?
So, yes, they knew about that.
Were they just looking the other way on his drug trafficking?
The problem is that for the White House, I mean, for the administration, for the Reagan administration, Nicaragua was so important, and the focus of all the foreign policy of the United States in Central America was in Nicaragua and in the fight against the communists. So for them, drugs was something in second place.
Drugs took second place.
Yes.
Noriega's Contra support earned him powerful friends in Washington, including the CIA director William Casey. Noriega was on his payroll at a reported $200,000 a year.
That was a very special relationship.
What kind of special relationship?
Well, Noriega talked with Casey. I have at least that I know more than 3 meetings. And always he's received the support of Casey.
What kind of support from Casey?
All kind of support, political support. So when somebody tried to investigate anything, the case stopped. Look, this is a very important piece in all this war.
So Casey would actually stop investigations of Noriega?
It's the man that helped Noriega very much.
According to Blandone, Noriega was not the only drug trafficker to reap the rewards of Contra support. The cocaine cartel also saw the advantages of backing U.S. policy.
That's the reason why the cartel of Medellin decided in 1983 to cooperate with the Contra.
So you're saying in 1983, the cartel started supporting the Contras?
Yes.
And the reason was because they knew that they could therefore get protection?
Yes.
How did they help them out? Was it arms plus cash, or was it just arms? How did that work?
They work in different ways. First, they established the network to supply arms, and also they pay in cash.
If one wants to organize an armed resistance or an armed undertaking for any purposes, the easy place to get the money and the easy places to get the guns are in the drug world.
General Paul Gorman was the commander of the U.S. Southern Command, based in Panama from 1982 to 1985.
The most ready source of money, big money, easy money, fast money, sure money, cash money, is the narcotics.
General Gorman was asked whether the Contras could have relied on drug cash.
Based on your knowledge of how it works and what you understood from your experience down there, it wouldn't surprise you.
Not at all, particularly if they'd been on somebody's payroll and had their funds cut off. That would be the natural recourse of those people.
How much money was actually contributed by you or through you for the Contras, total?
It was a little under $10 million.
I presume it wasn't all sent in one suitcase.
Oh, no. It was delivered on a per-need basis. You know, they'd say we need so much at such a location, and we take care of the logistics of it.
Milian Rodriguez says he used a series of Cuban-controlled front companies in Miami and Costa Rica to funnel the $10 million to the Contra cause. These fronts range from banks to obscure fish companies, located in out-of-the-way Miami shopping centers or in provincial port towns in Costa Rica. The route for the drug cash was carefully disguised.
Are you familiar with the name of a company called Frigoríficos de Punteranas?
Yes, sir, I am.
What is that company?
Well, it's a shrimp processing warehouse, but more importantly, it was one of the fronts that we used.
Did you set it up? What role did you play in it?
I was a key person in setting up the interlocking chain of companies around Frigoríficos de Punta Arenas.
Were payments or arrangements made by which the Contras could receive money through Frigorificos?
Yes, sir.
If you add up what it costs to run the Contra operation, and you get to a bottom line figure, and you deduct from that the known sources, you're going to have a tremendous deficit. And I think the question's got to be where the deficit, you know, how was the deficit taken care of?
There was a deficit.
Yes.
They realized that.
And we took care of it.
I've been spending some time looking at the numbers here of the amount of aid that the Contras were getting at various times. And I come to the conclusion that we're missing something. That there's got to be another source of funding for the Contras other than those which this committee has so far identified.
Last summer, the Iran-Contra committees were aware that there had been an unacknowledged source of money from somewhere.
I think there's got to be some other source of funds that meaning this committee, has not yet uncovered.
Well, I don't think I can help you there. I don't know of anything else.
The war costs so much every day.
Mm-hmm.
They were getting a certain amount, thanks to you, through Switzerland.
And many others, yes.
And many others. But the war costs more than that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea how much more it cost?
Well, I think Director Casey asked me a similar question in the spring of 86, I think it was. And I told him that I thought that the Contra effort would need a minimum of $10 million over the next 3 months, over and above the monies that we could apply in order to hang in there through the summer months until the Congress would act. There was some expectation in the White House, I guess, and in state that the Congress would act much sooner than they acted. Things were going downhill rapidly.
Did the people who received this money, were they aware of the fact that this was drug money, the proceeds came from drug money?
Let's put it like this, Senator D'Amato, the Contra peasant in the field did not, but the men who made the contact with me did. At that time, I was under indictment. I mean, I was red hot.
His arrest was well publicized. The $5 million seized with him brought Vice President Bush to Miami to pose with what the money launderer termed his petty cash.
Did Ramon Million Rodriguez have any friends who were working in the Contra resupply network?
Yes.
Who would that have been?
Felix Rodriguez.
Felix Rodriguez?
Yes.
A veteran of the Artime organization and the CIA, Felix Rodriguez was a key member of the White House resupply network. The Senate was told by the money launderer that it was Felix Rodriguez who solicited the drug cash.
If you have a fellow that's a tremendous patriot like Felix Rodriguez, who has sacrificed his personal needs for the cause of fighting communism, and all of a sudden he finds himself in a position where his troops are going to run out of money. They won't have money for bullets, for food, for medicine. I think in the case of Felix, it might have been something done out of desperation. They had to get money, and they were willing to get it from any source to continue their war.
When they go on the offense, they burn up a lot of ammunition, weapons, need a lot of air resupply, radios, uniforms, boots, food, all this stuff. You know, the cost just goes up.
Well, there are allegations that that Felix Rodriguez was desperately trying to make up that deficit.
If he was, it certainly didn't come to our attention.
So you had no knowledge of it?
No, not at all.
Well, the allegations are that he tried to make up the deficit by soliciting money from drug traffickers in
Florida. I thought you were circling back to that, but certainly we didn't hear anything like that at the time. As I said, Felix is no friend of mine, but I'd be astonished if he were involved with drug traffickers. I really would.
When General Noriega told you that Felix Rodriguez was friendly with Ramon Million Rodriguez, were you surprised to hear that Felix Rodriguez would be involved with a drug trafficker?
Surprised? Why?
According to Blandone, while Felix Rodriguez was supplying the Contras from Ilopango, he was receiving arms shipments arranged with the help of this man, Mike Harari, a former Israeli intelligence agent and a key aide to General Noriega. Harari, says Blandone, was also in business with the cocaine cartel, using the same network to ship arms and drugs, all with the sanction of the CIA. Did he get involved with narcotics trafficking in the course of helping to supply the Contras with weapons?
Yeah, that was part of the business.
So he was moving cocaine?
Yes.
From Colombia to the United States?
No. They moved the cocaine from Colombia to Panama, to the airstrip in Costa Rica or Honduras, to the United States.
At the same time that he was gathering up arms for the Contras?
Yes.
Where were the arms coming from?
From Yugoslavia and from the East Bloc, the communist countries.
From 1983 to 1985, says Blandone, this network, supported by Israeli and U.S. intelligence, was a major source of arms for the Contras.
Harari, the Israeli who was working with Noriega, was working with Felix Rodriguez?
Yes.
And Harari, at the same time, was involved with drug trafficking.
Yes.
Who was Felix Rodriguez working for or with when he approached you?
Well, the only government mention that he made was Vice President Bush.
And what was his relationship with Bush, as you understand it?
He was reporting directly to Bush. I was led to believe he was reporting regularly to the Vice President.
He was in touch with the VP's office on a number of occasions. I really don't know. I've never understood that relationship.
The request for the contribution made a lot more sense because Felix was reporting to George Bush. If Felix had come to me and said, I'm reporting to anyone else, let's say, you know, Oliver North, I might have been more skeptical. I didn't know who Oliver North was, and I didn't know his background. But you know, if you have and let's say we'll call him an ex-CIA operative, even though it's not true, he's a current operative.
Who is?
Felix. You know, everyone says he's ex-CIA. Well,
this is Felix Rodriguez.
Yeah, there's nothing ex about him. But if you have a CIA, what you consider to be a CIA man, coming to you saying, I want to fight this war, we're out of funds, can you help us out? I'm reporting directly to Bush on it. I mean, it's very real, very believable. Here you have a CIA guy reporting to his old boss.
This February 1985 memo from General Paul Gorman confirms that Bush and the Cuban had known each other for years, and that Rodriguez's primary responsibility was Nicaragua and the Contra FDN forces. Rodriguez, quote, is operating as a private citizen, but his acquaintanceship with the vice president is real enough, going back to the latter's days as director of Central Intelligence. Rodriguez's primary commitment to the region is in Nicaragua, where he wants to assist the FDN.
Did you say anything to Vice President Bush about your activities on behalf of this resupply operation?
No, sir. Not to him or anyone his staff.
But when Hasenfuss was shot down, the first call that Rodriguez made from Central America was to a staffer of Vice President Bush. Questions about that call forced the Bush office to put out a summary, listing 17 meetings with Rodriguez, including three with Bush himself. Nevertheless, the vice president has insisted that these contacts with Rodriguez concerned only El Salvador, not the Contras.
He wasn't selling drugs. He was just raising money. Tainted money, granted, but for a very good cause.
Felix Rodriguez claims he met with the cartel's money launderer only once and never solicited cash.
We permitted narcotics. I mean, we were complicitous as a country in narcotics traffic at the same time as we're spending countless dollars in this country to try to get rid of this problem. It's mind-boggling.
Is the war on drugs a big priority in this country, really?
Oh, no. No, it's largely a joke. There is no war on drugs. No president who's ever announced one has ever fought one. And no president who's ever announced one has ever given the soldiers the ammunition with which to fight one.
The intelligence agencies of this country, by God, should be involved in this battle instead of working with the scum of the earth, which they've been doing. They should be involved in this battle as a crusade for the survival of this country and this hemisphere.
I don't know if we've got the worst intelligence system in the world. I don't know if we've got the best, and they knew it all and just overlooked it. But no matter how you look at it, something's wrong. Something is really wrong out there.
Now, you can deny U.S. government involvement in drugs all you want, but the patterns are there, and the players are there popping up again, and you know, eventually someone is going to realize that what the truth is.
This summer, both Ramon Millian Rodriguez and Felix Rodriguez are expected to testify publicly in front of Senator Kerry's committee about the drug cartel's alleged $10 million contribution to the Contras. Vice President Bush declined to be interviewed for this program or to reply to Frontline's written questions about his relationship with Felix Rodriguez. Thank you for joining us. I'm Judy Woodruff. Good night.
Next week, the future of the U.S. commitment to the NATO alliance.
We're the cutting edge, the front line, the first people that will be engaged in any type of conflict.
But when nuclear weapons are reduced in Europe, could the armies of NATO actually win a war?
We feel that our skills outnumber their numbers.
Watch The Defense of Europe.
Frontline is produced for the Documentary Consortium by WGBH Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding for Frontline was provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide, and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Educational organizations may inquire about video cassettes by calling 1-800-424-7963. For a transcript of this program, please send $4 to Frontline, Box 322, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134.